Welcome to this course on flight simulation. In this course, we're going to learn about how to build a flight simulator, including both the physics and the graphics. So we'll get into some example ways to code up the graphics. And of course, those will depend on the platform that you want to put this on, but we'll use one example. We'll develop a code that can do it on a certain platform. But first, we're actually going to focus on the physics. The physics is dominated by this set of equations. These are the equations that govern rigid body flight of an object through the atmosphere. And these equations we developed earlier in previous videos. And if you're not familiar with them, you can go back and review those videos. And I'll put links at the bottom here. To those videos, you can go back and refresh your memory. But let's just talk about what these are for a moment. These are the equations of motion, and these are 12 first order differential equations that are nonlinear. Okay, so we have our changes in velocity, u, v, and w, changes in p, q, and r, changes in x, y, z, and changes in our Euler angles here, phi, theta, psi. And those depend on the actual values of these 12 variables. These 12 variables we call the states of the aircraft. Okay, so we have, we're gonna be tracking 12 variables that are called the states of the aircraft, the 12 states. So these are the actual values for U, V, W, P, Q, R, X, Y, Z, phi, theta, psi. If we have all 12 of those values, then we know the entire state of the aircraft, okay? And so the changes in those states, the changes in those 12 variables depend on the current state of the aircraft, as well as some additional information, such as the weight of the aircraft. You can see a W right here, the inertia tensor of the aircraft, the gyroscopic information on the aircraft, and also what we've done here is included wind. This is for constant wind. If the wind was constant throughout the flight, then we could include it this way here as just an addition to our XYZ location here or velocities. Okay, so let's just kind of walk through these equations and remind ourselves where they come from. So the top two equations here are the so these right here, those are come from Newton's second law, which is basically F equals ma. So you're probably very familiar with that, more specifically the top equation is exactly that, F equals ma. So on the left hand side, for example, we have acceleration, the change in our velocities. Remember, u, v, and w are the velocities in the body fixed coordinate system. And so the changes in velocity is an acceleration. So we've solved for acceleration here on the left-hand side and then divided the mass over to the other side. And so we have forces. So for example, these are aerodynamic forces divided by mass. That's g over w there. We also have, this is our weight vector. So that's another force divided by the mass, that's that term there. And the direction that our weight vector is pointing depends on the orientation of the aircraft, its bank angle and elevation angle theta. Okay, and then we have these other forces called Coriolis forces over here. So anyway, this top equation is actually F equals ma, we've just rearranged it. The second equation is F equals ma, but in a rotational sense. So this is our change in rotational velocities, p, q, and r. So remember, those are rotations about each of the axes, the x, y, z body fixed axes on board the aircraft. And the rotational or change in those velocities depends on the inertia of the aircraft, the gyroscopic information on board the aircraft, and that can come from rotating propellers or jet engines or other instruments that have some kind of a gyroscopic property. And then we've got the moment. So this is the aerodynamic moments. Actually, these are called the pseudo aerodynamic moments. These are the pseudo aerodynamic forces. So these are the aerodynamic forces and moments, including thrust. And then we have a bunch of other terms here that I guess are probably akin to these Coriolis forces, but are rotational or moments that are created based off of our rotation rates of the aircraft. Okay, so that's what these top six equations are basically. F equals ma, because this is a 6 degree of freedom, we have three translational equations. So these are the translational equations up here, and then we have three rotational equations. So we're a full 6 degree of freedom. So I'll write that here, 6 degree of freedom equations here. Okay, one thing that we've assumed here is that these are, this is for a rigid body. So the equations that, become more complicated once you start to assume that the aircraft or this object is not rigid, and so it can have elastic effects, it can change shape during flight, and that there's fluid structure interaction there. So we're going to assume a rigid body throughout this course. It's a good starting point for flight simulation, and then you can add the complexity later if it's needed. Okay, so let's go on to this next equation here, or this next set of equations. This is x dot, y dot, z dot. So these are the change in our Earth fixed coordinate system. And what we've done here is actually assumed a flat Earth. Okay, so this is a flat Earth approximation for these dynamic equations here. So we're just assuming that X is aligned, directed at the North Pole. So it's directed due north, Y is to the east, and Z is towards the center of the Earth, okay? So, but we're assuming a flat Earth, and that's actually a pretty good approximation for short durations of flight. You know, of course, if you have really long durations of flight, then that doesn't work. And we'll actually, near the end of this course, talk about how you actually map that then onto into latitude and longitude and altitude instead, so that you don't have to make those approximations. So the physics are based off of flat Earth, but then we can map that to where you would be on a global scale, on a round Earth. Okay, so the changes in X, Y, and Z depend on our orientation of the aircraft and our velocities, U, V, and W. And then again, like I mentioned earlier, we're adding a wind vector here. And so basically we're assuming that you have constant wind throughout the entire flight. Now, if you want to add in gusts and things like that, again, these equations would need to be modified. And hopefully we'll get to that point in this course as well. But as we've written these equations as a review here, we're assuming a constant wind vector. Okay, and then finally, down here, we have phi dot, theta dot, and psi dot. So this is our change in orientation. Remember, phi is our bank angle, theta is our elevation angle, and psi is our azimuth angle or heading. And so our changes in our orientation depend on our current orientation, as well as our rotation rates, p, q, and r. Okay, so these six equations down here are called our kinematic transformation equations, and these are built off of, right now, these are, in fact, let me just label those. So these are the kinematic transformation equations. Okay, so that's those two sets of equations. Really, there's six equations there. And what we've assumed here is we're using Euler angles. It's called the Euler angle formulation for those kinematic transformation equations. There are actually different ways that you can formulate these six equations, and we're going to talk about a few of those other options throughout throughout this course here. But what we've done here is used Euler angles. So this is the phi, theta, psi. The nice thing about these is that they're really intuitive. So if you see the value of a bank angle, for example, you can kind of imagine what that means, how the aircraft is oriented, or theta or psi. You know, just from the values here, we can we have a really good feel for what that means for how the aircraft is oriented. And some of the other methods that we're going to use, for example, the one that we're going to actually end up coding up as our final method is a quaternion representation of for the orientation of the aircraft. And quaternions have a lot of benefits over the Euler angle formulation in terms of computational speed and complexity. However, they are not quite as intuitive, you know, so you couldn't see the values of the quaternion and have a real feel for how the aircraft is oriented. You'd really need to transfer those back into Euler angles to be able to picture how the aircraft is oriented. So anyway, so there's pros and cons to each. One of the cons here to the Euler angle formulation is that we get this thing called gimbal lock. So what happens is if cosine of theta is zero, which happens when your nose is pointed directly up or directly down, you can see that we get this divide by zero in a few places. And that's called gimbal lock. That these equations are undefined in that state. And so anyway, that's one of the drawbacks of the Euler angle formulation, and the quaternions don't suffer from that. So that's another reason that we'll use quaternions. Okay. So these are our 12 equations, and these are this is just some information to remember about these equations. Maybe one last thing I'll add on here is that these are 12 first order differential equations, and they are actually nonlinear. So first of all, the first order means that we have the first derivative over here is equal to something that is equal to information on the right-hand side that's just based off of the actual value or the states of the aircraft. And so that's what the first order means, is that we've got the first derivative over here. The nonlinear portion means that there are nonlinear terms in here. So we have two states of the aircraft that are multiplied together, for example, and that happens all over the place in here. These are highly nonlinear. You can see that up in here and all throughout these equations here. So these are nonlinear first order differential equations. And so what we've done previously, or what you can do, is you can linearize these equations and come up with approximations for things like the natural frequencies of the aircraft that is going to see in flight, or the rigid body dynamics. So you can get approximations for the fugoid and Dutch roll modes and short period modes and things like that. But that's based off of linearized approximations to these equations. Really, these full equations are nonlinear. And in this course, we're going to learn how to retain all of this nonlinearity and integrate forward in time, so we get actual or more correct information about this aircraft, by simulating it in time and capturing all of these nonlinearities. So basically what we're going to be learning to do is to integrate each of these 12 equations forward in time and retain the full nonlinearity of the equations. Okay, so that's a brief overview of where we're going with these equations here. And again, this represents the physics portion of the flight simulation course. We're also going to have some graphics where we talk about how to put this into a graphics engine and be able to visualize what the aircraft is doing as well. But the physics is a real important part of that, and that's where we're going to start off. One last thing that I want to mention here is that these equations are highly coupled. And what I mean by that is often after you linearize these equations, and if you assume that the aircraft is perfectly symmetric, then you can decouple these equations into a longitudinal and lateral equations. And those decouple when you linearize and assume that the aircraft is symmetric. But what we've done here with this full set of equations is we're assuming that the aircraft is not necessarily symmetric. So this inertia tensor, for example, several of those terms would drop out if the aircraft were perfectly symmetric. But we're going to retain these. We're also going to retain gyroscopic effects, which also create some coupling here. So we're going to include the longitudinal and lateral coupling. Those are naturally included in this full set of equations. And in previous developments, we have dropped that out or been able to divide this into two sets of equations, one longitudinal set of equations and one lateral set of equations. And that's what you do basically in order to come up with these closed form solutions or approximations for the dynamic modes. But we're not going to do that. We're going to keep it all together here. So again, it's a more accurate representation of the aircraft.